Hello, we are looking at differentiation. We're going to examine the product rule. So the product rule is finding the gradient function or derivative of the product of two functions, an f of g multiplied by a different function, g of x. So we are going to differentiate by first principles. So that is using our definition here for df dx, taking the limit for the rate of change for h to go to zero. Okay, so let's just start with the differentiation by first principles and see what kind of expression we will get when we use our product of two functions. So here we go. We're interested in what is the derivative of a f times the g function. So limit as h goes to zero. All right, so let's set this up. First half it is f of x plus h. So we've got two parts now. F of x plus h times the second function. Okay. Now, from that, we may not know what to do. How can we simplify that? Well, it's not obvious. So we're going to manipulate it a little bit with a little trick. We're going to include another part in there to see if we can, with this new added part, see if we can manipulate it then. Okay, so this here, we've still got the limit as h goes to zero. All right, so there's the first term. All right, so now what I'm going to do is, in the middle here, I'm going to add in a new term as my little manipulation. So, if I add in times g of x. Okay, so by including that little term, I'm going to see how that's going to affect our result, our manipulation. Okay, but I just can't include a term out of nowhere because it just changes it altogether. It's not equivalent to the previous line. So I have to balance that out. I got to subtract that away as well. Okay, and still we've still got the last part of it that we can't neglect. All over h. Okay, now what do we notice? Well, if we can factorize some common factors out, then we might be able to get an equivalent expression that we can recognize, that we can draw upon. Well, first off, what parts have common factors? Well, the common factors here could be the f of x plus h. Well, we've got another f of x plus h somewhere throughout here. There's one here, and there's another one in the middle here, but this one here is not going to be the most useful one to draw. I'm going to match this second one with the first term there and take out that common factor of f of x plus h. All right, let's see what's left from the first term. G of an x plus h minus g of x. Well, that's okay, that's useful, because here I've got a difference in the g function. That's in the similar definition to the top, the whole definition of the gradient function itself. It looks similar now, and I'm going to make that connection shortly. All right, what about another term? Well, another term has a common factor also. We can see we have one here, g of x. G of x is a common factor. So I'm going to take out that factor of g of x. And what's left is an f of an x plus h minus f of x. Okay. All on h. All right. So if we think about what we've ended up with, we recognize that we now have two expressions that each itself are in this structure, the definition of the gradient function itself. They do look like that. So let's see if we can break it down into that. So the first one is, well, here we go. We have the first term here. We've got this common factor f of x plus h out the front, but with a denominator of h, we have g of x plus h minus g of x. Okay? That's from the first part that we have here. All right. Now, what about the second term? Well, I'm going to carry my limit function over to the second term as well. Well, the second term, we have our common factor of g of x, but now we've got f of x plus h minus f of x all on h. Okay, and each term is the same structure for the definition of the gradient function. And that's useful because we're going to call it something else now. When we take the limit as h goes to 0 of each expression, the first one is going to become, here we can see this part there, we've just got the h that is adding to the x. So if we make that part go to 0, then it just becomes f of x. And that's multiplying the fraction. Now, if we take the limit of this whole fraction as h goes to 0, what do we get out of that? Well, we're told that this is the same as the definition of the df dx, the gradient function itself. So this is function g, so we get a dg dx term. Okay, and then what about the second term? What do we end up there? Well, we've got our g of x function, but that is multiplying a df of x dx. There it is. Okay, this here is a gradient function for the product of two functions, f and g. All right, we call that the product rule. And so we can write our product rule in a more simple way. We have our product of two functions, f and g, we call that y. But if we give f a function of x and function of g different nicknames or different labels, then it gives us a more simple rule to write. So we're going to let u is equal to f of x, and let v is equal to g of x. So then the product rule can be expressed in this form. Okay, now our dash notation, u dash and v dash, they are the derivatives. So u dash is a dy dx, and v dash is a dv dx. Okay, so that's an important thing to recognize in our little notation of the rule. All right, so let's put the product rule to test. We're going to differentiate this function. Y is equal to e to the power of negative 2x times, multiplied by, cos of 3 on pi times x. Alright, so let's try it. First off, let's identify the two functions and label them with a u and a v. So let u is equal to the first function. Okay. And well, since we found the u function, let's go ahead and work out its derivative. Then du dx becomes negative 2 e to the negative 2x. Okay, that's right. Now what else do we have? Well, we've got our v function. V is equal to cos of 3 on pi x. Okay, and since we've got that, let's work out the derivative of that function. Okay, so derivative of cos is what? Who remembers? Well, it becomes this minus sine function with that k value, the value multiplying the x, that comes out the front. All right. Good. So now we've achieved all our four parts that we need to use, and we can now substitute them into the chain rule formula. All right, so dy dx is then going to be, well, we've got our, we can start with the u dash first, and then times the v, and then the u function and times the v dash function. There's the formula. Let's put all the parts and substitute them in their spot. So the u dash part is, when we do substitution, we use the brackets, negative 2 e to the negative 2x times the v function, which is cos 3 on pi x, okay, and then plus, all right, now substitute the u function, e to the negative 2x. And the last bit is the v dash function. So that's the negative 3 on pi sine. Okay. 3 on pi x. Okay. And there we have it. So we've put all our parts into the formula. And now we just have to simplify the terms and pretty much clean up the rule and write it in a more simple way. So, what do we have? Well, in both terms, we've got this common factor of the exponential number. So sometimes finding that common factor, taking out that common factor, is a good way of writing it. So here we have it. Common factor of e to the negative 2x. Okay, and then there's n also, a negative sign, a negative 1 is also a common factor, so let's bring that negative out. So we've got now 2 cos 3 on pi x. Okay, we've taken out the negative 1 from the second term, so it's now positive, and all that's left is 3 on pi sine 3 on pi x. Okay. And there's a neater way of expressing the derivative of that product function. What do you think? So that's an example of the product rule. Let's do one more. Here we go. We've got this function, the square root of x multiplied by the log of 2x. And let's find that derivative. All right. So the first thing to do is let u is equal to the first function. Work out its derivative. Okay, all right, just recognize that u here is an x to the power of a half. So then we can use our power term rule to get its derivative. It becomes a half times x to the power of negative a half, which is 1 over 2 root x. Okay. No, you just be careful as you're working with power terms to make sure you get the right power correct. Now, let's do the same for our v function, the second one. This is a log, base e of 2x. Okay, the derivative function. Okay, now, who remembers the derivative of a log function? Well, it's almost the something in regards to a reciprocal of x, 1 on x, but what happens to the 2 in front of the x here? Does it come out the front, or it actually does, but it gets cancelled out at the same time. So it becomes just 1 over x as the derivative of any log function. Okay, good. Now, let's put those 1, 2, 3, 4 parts together in our product rule. So, therefore, we have y dx. All right, so we can write it as a u v dash plus u dash v. That's okay writing it like that. As long as we have one function times the derivative of the other plus, and then we change the derivative of the function times the function of the other. Okay, so we have u function, which is square root of x. Put in the gradient function, which is this one, 1 on x. Okay, and then u dash, which is 1 on 2 root x. And finally, the v function log. Very good. Okay, finally, we just tidy it up. So the first term, it's important to recognize they're all power terms, and we can simplify it by using index laws. So this is an x to a half on x, okay? And by itself, it has a power of 1, so we have to subtract the exponents there. And then in the second term, we can see we've... there aren't any factors that are in the numerator denominator that we can divide, cancel out, so we just have to leave it as is. So maybe we will put this time the log just in the numerator. Log e of 2x all on 2 root x. Okay, and finally, let's fix this up. Now, we'll notice the first fraction becomes power of a negative a half, which is good. And now we've got negative a half being 1 over the square root of x. So we've got square root of x as a common denominator. So if a common denominator of 2 root x, we'll have 2 plus log. That's e of 2x all on 2 root x. It's a simple fraction. All right, you can check going through some working out steps to check to see if that's correct, and you'll be pleasantly surprised. Okay, well, I think we have got a good beginning understanding of our product rule, so let's explore that and practice some more examples.